The following is a Just Green production brought to you by the Might Be News Network.
What's up, everybody? This is Might Be Sports. My name is Taylor Cooper. With me, as always, Kevin Reavy. What's going on, Reavy?
What's going on? How do you do?
It is the week of October 26th, 2020. Go to mbnnetwork.com. It's never been easier for you to find your new favorite podcast. It looks incredible. We have a whole bunch of new stuff on there, some page profiles. Go in there. Click your favorite show. For example, Might Be Sports. If you love Might Be Sports, go to mbnnetwork.com and click on the Might Be Sports banner on the bottom. And in there, it will bring you to a place where you can have all the episodes of the show, so you don't have to dig through on Apple. You don't have to dig through anywhere. This puts all the episodes of Might Be Sports readily available for you. It's an incredible tool, and you can do that for all the shows here at the network. We're also sponsored by Eunomia CBD. Go to eunomiacbd.com. Use promo code MBN. Get 20% off, free shipping and free shit. It's really incredible stuff. They got bath bombs. They got lollipops. They got gummies. They got pet treats. They got all kinds of stuff. Please go to eunomiacbd.com. Check it out. Use promo code MBN. Kevin Reavy, how are you doing today?
Doing good. Might not sound too good. We got the microphone.
But
it ain't plugged in.
Yeah. So we're working out. We're still working out some kinks here at the network. We got, as you
next
know,
week.
Everybody's doing remote right now. So we went out. We got some microphones for everybody to kind of try at home. And, you know, right now we're just kind of getting through all that. So, Reavy, it's all good. They don't make a lot of, like, Apple stuff. They don't use the fucking – it's all Apple's fault. They don't use USBs. It's ridiculous.
Well, I'll tell you what's crazy is that I was, like, one of the first guys to get the iPad when it came out. So my goal when the iPad came out, people don't really remember, but it wasn't actually that popular a product. Like, it wasn't an instant smash hit. Right. So I was like one of the first people that I knew that had an iPad. And I remember thinking to myself, that was right around the time when I wanted to start writing a book. And I thought to myself, I want to be like the first one to write a book on an iPad. Like, now it seems like, you know,
everybody's on.
Like, I wrote the last one on my phone for the most part. Like, I totally phased out of laptops once I got the iPad, and haven't really had one since. And I have this MacBook that I use just for this. And as I was unfolding it just now, I'm like, I don't see where a USB would fit. It's one of those like airs. It's literally like this thin. So I totally struck out on that. Struck out, sports reference.
There you go.
The podcast is going to be a home run. Anyway.
So
I'm going to go now.
That was a joke. Speaking of a joke, how about that NFC East? But I'm pumped.
More like NFC Least.
Am I right?
Whoa. Copyright that.
That was an original thought. They're 5-18-1 as of this recording. After following an abysmal performance by the Cowboys on Monday Night Football, Andy Dalton is trash, okay? Zeke is playing like trash. The Cowboys look like trash. And it became clear to me that somebody might win the NFC East this year with 5 wins. Maybe less.
Popular belief right now is that it's going to be 6.
Okay.
So 6 is a possibility. The Eagles have, the Giants, Cowboys. I'm not sure. Well, they have an easy 3-game stretch coming up where they could win all 3. And then it's like, oh, man, their magic number is 2 at that point.
Right.
It's got to get the 6 wins, and they're good to go.
Right.
But it could all turn on a dime. I'm still a believer in Andy Dalton. I'm actually a believer in this Eagles team. This Fulgham guy, their wide receiver.
Dude, he looks good.
Total revelation. I was telling everybody last week, I said, if you're fantasy, maybe not so much fantasy, but if you're into gambling and you want a free bet, take the over on Greg Ward yards. And the reason why I thought that was that the previous week is when Fulgham really kind of blew up or kind of like solidified himself. He had that touchdown out of nowhere. And the following week, he backed it up with like 6 or 7 catches, 100 yards, and another touchdown. So 2 straight games with a touchdown. And by no means do I think Greg Ward is a star type player where teams are going to just focus on him. But I thought, you know, with this wide receiver core, Greg Ward's the best of a real garbage heap. So I kind of figured they were focusing on Ward a little bit, and then Fulgham was just getting open with the second cornerback on each team. But, I mean, I couldn't be more wrong. I thought Ward was going to have a breakout game because it was going to shift. The teams were going to start focusing on Fulgham now that they had 2 straight great games. It just turns out that Fulgham might just be a really good player. And you saw it before the half yesterday. You know, Wentz just throws it up on 4th down and just gave his wide receiver a chance to make a play. That's an Alshon Jeffrey kind of deal. Right. And he went up and he got it. So, you know, he's the real deal. I couldn't have been more wrong on Greg Ward. 3 games now for Fulgham. You don't want to get too ahead of yourself, but you see all the markings of a good wide receiver. So if anything comes out of this, you know, the Eagles get back Alshon, maybe even Deshaun Jackson at some point, that could maybe piece together something and make a run.
Yeah, I mean, the way that NFL stars are born, it's not always the big names from college. It's not always these guys that you know, start day one. It's these guys, you know, a lot of times it's these guys that were totally overlooked, totally underscouted, totally just maybe they underperformed at the combine. Maybe they didn't even get invited to the combine. It's you know, it's really incredible how the NFL can really turn, I'm doing air quotes, garbage into gold. And how that works out is unparalleled in other sports, right? Because, like, very, very, very rarely is there an NBA star that just, like, holy shit, nobody even saw this coming, right? Like, usually it's somebody that they've been following since high school, even. You know, LeBron James, we're going to get into that here in a minute. But, you know, very rarely is there, like, a star player. There's like a publicly, you know, public star player, like people like somebody, people like this player or whatever, but like we're talking star level shit. I feel like that pops up in the NFL a lot with like no name people, which is always fun to watch, and this guy kind of seems that way. I was also very impressed with Carson Wentz on Sunday, at least in the later in the third quarter and in the fourth quarter. I really stand by the fact that, though, that this is the worst NFC East I've ever seen, ever. I think it'll be hilarious if the Eagles and the Giants tie on Thursday night. that's kind of what I'm leaning towards, to be honest. It's a shit show. And anyway, I don't know. I'm interested. It's a very good NFL season so far. It's
well into it.
I'm definitely into it.
Being an Eagles fan, I basically described it as, you know, if you're an Eagles fan, you don't want them to win this and make the playoffs because you think it's kind of garbage to limp in like that, and it doesn't mean anything, and it takes away from your draft slot, all that kind of deal. What you're basically saying is you'd rather the Redskins, Cowboys, or Giants make the playoffs instead, and I can't get on board with that. So I'm still all in with the Eagles. It's just these are many – I mean, the division is the deal. That's the game. That's the season. That's the tournament.
Right.
We're just trying to win this tournament. It may look ugly, but I mean, you know my opinion on hockey. I think the NHL Stanley Cup playoffs are ugly. I mean, they're exciting. But as a format, they're ugly as hell. You just half the teams make it, and then you're just rolling dice. Who the hell knows how it's going to turn out?
Well, and
same thing here. It's just, you know, nobody's winning games. But eventually, never in the history of the NFL in the division format has a really quote unquote bad team made it. I think there was like a 7-9 team. That might have been the Seahawks a few years ago, but they were a good team on the up. So I think eventually it's going to be the Eagles, and they could go on a run like last year, close it out strong, and you know, they could still finish this thing above 500.
Yeah. I mean, it's going to be interesting to see how the Eagles shape it up. They're dealing with so many injuries. Hopefully Carson Wentz can stay healthy. You know, I really don't know. I just, for me, I want to see them win. And obviously, like you said, the division is the goal here. And realistically speaking, in any playoff format across all sports, all you have to do is get in. Mm-hmm. All you have to do is get in, and then anything can happen, especially in the NFL, because it's a one-off playoff system. You know what I mean? Like, you can squeak it a win out against the Vikings with the double doink, and that's all that matters is the W. So, you know, right. You're right. All you have to do is just get in. And I'm kind of on the fence about the whole drafting and tank versus tanking thing, because for me right now, the team is trash. You don't need anything special to see that. You know what I mean? And to me, it's just like we talked about it before with these old contracts, with these old players. It's like, all right, well, if we are shitty, then we get better draft picks, which is kind of what we want. But then the problem is that the Eagles, correct me if I'm wrong, don't have a plethora of draft picks right now because they've traded them all away to do whatever the fuck it is that they've done. I don't know what the answer is. I just know that it's a frustrating season. It wasn't what I think that anybody pictured it being, certainly. So we'll just have to see how it goes. Switching gears, though.
Well, let me just say one thing.
Yeah, go ahead.
I don't think it's ever correct to just root to stay out of the playoffs and not get in there. Just get in there, see what happens. That's what you're rooting for. And it's not always about winning a championship. The best games that I've seen in my life, I mean, in my lifetime, I've seen, if you don't count Villanova, I've seen two championships in Philly.
Right.
Does that mean every other game was a disappointment? It doesn't measure up?
Right.
That would mean that only, you know, game five of the World Series in 2008 and then the Super Bowl in 2017, 2018, those were the only games that mattered. I don't believe that.
Right.
So get into the playoffs, make some memories. And you know what? Drafting in a higher slot, there's no guarantee that's going to matter anyway.
It's true.
If the Eagles hadn't made the playoffs last year, they'd had the Cowboys spot. Did they take CeeDee Lamb or they still go with Jalen friggin' Reagor?
Right.
I mean, the guy they should have drafted on everybody's board, Justin Jefferson? Oh, yeah, he just had 175 yards and two touchdowns again.
Right.
He's got 572 yards, I think, this year and four or five touchdowns. 21-year-old dude, what, five, six games into the season, he's got 570-some yards. I mean, Justin Jefferson was right there on everybody's draft board for the Eagles to take, and they go with Jalen Reagor. So who cares about draft slot? They can't draft anyway.
Yeah, they can't draft anyway. No, you're totally right, and it's a very valid point, and that's why I'm on the fence with it, right? Because, like, to me, it's just like, all right, there's definitely still a chance, especially because the division is such trash. But then in my mind, I'm just like, all right, well, if I see, let's go with three more losses in a row, like if they just can't get a win, if they just in the next three games just shit the bed, and let's just add another thing. If Carson Wentz gets hurt, to me, I'm just like, all right, hang it up. Let's see what draft position we can get into. And I'm not saying that that's going to happen, but, like, to me, that's what would propel me to be in a different frame of mind. You know what I mean? So that's just where I'm at with it. But switching gears, we haven't talked much about baseball at all since we've come back because I haven't watched any of it. But the World Series is getting ready to start. L.A. Dodgers versus the Tampa Bay Rays. Who do you think is going to win and why?
I think this is, you know, it's tough because the Dodgers have the reputation of kind of failing in the playoffs, but or in the postseason. But I don't know. I mean, they've got a World Series appearance under their belt. I'm trying to remember how – I think that game might have – that series might have went seven games, I think, against the Astros. I'm not entirely sure.
I think
it did. So I don't know. Maybe they're over that. Kershaw famously, you know, just is totally different player in the postseason. But
I was just getting ready to ask you, how has he been? How has he been in this postseason, Kershaw? How has he been?
I don't have the stats offhand. I know he had a couple. I think he had a couple not Clayton Kershaw starts, giving up home runs, and it's. It's what it seems to be. He'll start off strong and then just, but it's, that's just baseball now. I mean, balls just end up in the stands.
Yeah.
I mean, a guy will square up to bunt and it'll go 400 yards.
Right.
Or 400 feet. So it's tough to say. On paper, they have all the talent in the world. The Devil Rays, I think I saw a stat where you take the two highest paid players in the Yankees and they basically make about the same amount of money of the whole payroll of the Tampa Bay Rays. So that's the kind of deal we're talking about. I was just watching yesterday, I rewatched Moneyball. It's about almost 10 years old now, which is crazy. Like time is just flying by.
Yeah.
But it's so interesting that I'm looking back on like the Athletics. And if you know the story, you know, Billy Beane, the GM, constantly losing players to the Yankees has to figure out a way with mathematics and statistics to try to, you know, beat the casino, basically card counters, try to figure out a way with math to beat the game. And I thought, man, that's baseball is not really like that anymore, but except for the Rays and the Marlins and two teams that did pretty well this year. And it's kind of weird that it's still like that. And I just wonder how long that can go on. And we were talking about this before, I think last week, which is, let's say the Rays do win. Does it really matter long term? I mean, for the moment, like we were talking about moments, it's great.
Yeah.
The fan base, whatever fan base that is.
Right, right. It's great.
If you think about it, you know, almost all of the games, nobody could attend in person. So there's that disconnect right there with the fans. They don't have much of a fan base to begin with. What's it all for? They're not going to be back. I mean, the Marlins, when they won their two championships, they were just dismantled right afterwards. There's no longevity there when you cannot pay for good players and keep good players and stay consistent in that respect. So it just seems it's like the Toronto Raptors last year. It's great for them. They won the championship, but it's like, man, you really put yourself in a tight spot where you have like that 1 year window. And this was like the Rays. It was like their 1 year window where things are a little kooky, a little different, expanded playoffs. And you know, what's it all mean long-term? Do you even think about the Raptors anymore? Like it's so easy to forget that they won the championship last year in the NBA.
Right.
And how quickly are we going to forget the Rays won if they do? So as much as I'd like to root for the Rays, and I guess I will, it's hard to will yourself into certain things. I go into Super Bowls sometimes thinking like, all right, I'm going to root for this team and or that team. And then the game starts and just like my emotions take over and just I have no control over it. I'm all of a sudden rooting for the team I thought I was rooting against. So I won't know until the game starts tonight. And you guys will know the result of that. But yeah, I think the Dodgers pull it out. For no rhyme or reason that, I mean, I guess the best reason of all is they have the best players. And I think the players are, they're playing really good right now. I don't think there's much to be said with them having a tougher road. I think the Dodgers did have a little bit of a tougher road. The Braves were rough. That was a crazy game seven. You just, the big adage in sports in the playoffs is, when you get to that like league championship series or whatever its version would be in other sports, and it's so dramatic and so emotional, does it kind of take you out of the next step? I don't know, but a clear example in baseball is when the Red Sox came back from 03, they just tore through the World Series and won in four games.
Yeah.
So I could see that being the case. It's been a long time since the Dodgers won, I think 1988 maybe. So now's their time. They're the best team. They've been the best team all year. So
yeah. Yep. I don't have any real input on it. I just hopefully it's a good series.
Yeah, Cody Bellinger's playing great. I think Kershaw's going to be lights out. So they got, you know, they got a lot of power on the mound and in the batter's box, just all around.
Yeah.
They got it. They'll win.
Yeah. All right. So I wanted to talk about something because at the end of last week, LeBron James was my go to the week. And we kind of talked about his, you know, him being the actual goat. Okay. And how it's becoming harder and harder for me to defend disliking him as a player. And it's getting harder and harder for me to defend him not being the goat. But, all right. So I saw this image and I after the show, and I had to talk about it. Now I have not fact checked any of this. Okay. So if there's any glaring inconsistencies, please let me know. But this says Michael Jordan's best teammates on the road to winning six rings with zero finals losses. Okay. Scottie Pippen, 7-time All-Star. Dennis Rodman, 2-time All-Star. Horace Grant, 1-time All-Star. Steve Kerr, no All-Star appearances. Tony Kukoc, no All-Star appearances. LeBron James' best teammates on the road to winning 4 rings with 6 finals losses. Is that correct? Has he lost in the finals 6 times?
Well, I know you have the one series where that went 7 with Golden State.
Right.
So that's 3 losses right there. That's half of them in one. I don't know how many he lost 1 this time, so that's 4.
No. 6, like he lost in the finals. Like lost the championship.
6 times. Yeah. I was going to say, because he lost 4 apiece when he was with the Cavs. They went to at least 1 finals.
Is that right?
Yeah.
All right. So he,
we're just saying games. All right.
I'm talking series. I'm talking series,
not games.
Yeah.
He lost, was it twice with the Cavs or was it just once?
I don't know. That was staggering to me. I was like, that's crazy. But anyway, here's his best teammates with
only sound right.
With 4 rings.
I had 3 or 4 on top of my head, but yeah, go ahead.
He's got Dwayne Wade, 13-time All-Stars. Anthony Davis, 7-time All-Star. Kyrie Irving, 6-time All-Star. Chris Bosh, 11-time All-Star. Kevin Love, 5-time All-Star. Ray Allen, 10-time All-Star. Some guy, I really have no idea how to pronounce his name, 2-time All-Star. Honorable mentions, J.R. Smith, Kyle Korver, Rajon Rondo, Tristan Thompson, Dwight Howard, Mo Williams, Kyle Kuzma, to name a few. I can't give him the goat.
Who's the guy you can't pronounce? Now you have to pronounce his name.
Oh, geez. All right. Here, I'm going to try it. Oh, wow. This one's bad.
2-time All-Star? I can't even think who it is.
Zydrunas.
Zydrunas Ilgauskas.
That's it, dude. Say it again one more time.
Zydrunas Ilgauskas. He was one of those guys. You know, there's always one guy in every sport where it's like, they're the best player not currently in the pro league. Like, he was the best player not in the NBA.
Okay.
He was playing overseas. Can't remember where, like Croatian or something, but he came over at like age, I could be totally wrong on this, but I think I'm right. Like age 27. He was one of those guys, best player not in the NBA, and came over, had a damn good career. If I'm not totally. Hopefully I'm not confusing him with Arvydas Sabonis. I might be doing that. But Arvydas Sabonis is another one of those guys. I don't know. I can't use my phone right now because I'm using it as a spotlight. It's all – we got microphones that don't work, spotlights, and cell phone. I'm drinking whiskey. It's Tuesday.
So, whatever. But real quick, okay, because we're running out of time. Is this – how? Yeah. This makes me cringe.
How I feel about it? I believe that, you know, once LeBron James sold his soul to do the super team thing, he forever lost his opportunity to be considered the greatest of all time. He can win championships and do it that way, but it's a deal with the devil for a reason. You got to give something up. You don't get to have it both ways.
I am all about it, dude. I agree 1,000%. This confirms it for me that LeBron James, as a basketball player, is trash.
True.
I'm just kidding. He's not trash. He's literally the best player of this generation. But I can't give him the GOAT status, because looking at this, it makes sense to me. Like, it just makes sense. Again, I could see Space Jam 2 and totally change my mind. But for now, I'm still on MJ. Like, this is, you can't argue with me about this. Scottie Pippen went to 7 All-Star games. That's it. Everybody else, 2-1-0-0.
Yeah, I think he deserved more. But
he did deserve more. And he probably would have gotten more if he played today in today's NBA.
Playing second fiddle.
Absolutely. So, I don't know, man.
And then, Rondo, he was the point guard for a championship Celtics team. And he was kind of the glue that held all those pieces together. Really, a really interesting guy. If anybody wants to, like, Google, I don't have the story offhand. I'm surprised it's not talked about more. Maybe Rondo just doesn't do interviews or he's not that kind of guy, but very interesting article I read about him about 10 years ago where he's a genius. He's like a literal genius. He's got a photographic memory.
Oh, wow.
Nothing gets by the guy. They said at times in his career, college and the pros, he gets on coaches' nerves because he thinks on such a higher plane that he just thinks, I'm might be misquoting the situation, but for the most part, he kind of thinks that he knows what to do more than the coach does. He thinks he's smarter. He gets it more than the coach does. And he's kind of butt heads with his coaches in the past. But I've always thought about that. And I've always thought, like, man, that would be, if you can rein in that that character, if you can rein in that sense that he has that kind of makes him a problematic dude, why wouldn't you want that? That's the kind of thing that Jason Kidd had that everybody, you know, loved, was that Jason Kidd, like, just saw basketball like, you know, he's Neo in the Matrix. He really
right.
did.
Right. Well, I just thought that was interesting and wanted to bring that up.
See, I guess he has kind of ranged.
You're lagging bad. Lagging bad right there.
Yeah. I mean, once again, I want to change it.
You're lagging. I can't really hear you very
sorry.
Well.
Sorry. Am I back?
Kind of. It's all right. We're going to do Go to the Week and get out of here.
Mike B Sports presents the greatest of all time.
Of the Week. The greatest of all time of the week. Sponsored by Eunomia CBD. Go to EunomiaCBD.com. Use promo code MBN. Get 20% off free shipping and free shit. Stuff is a miracle drug. I'm telling you. Go do it. My go to the week, clear cut go to the week. Talked. I think it was maybe the first episode or the second. I don't remember, but talked about how terrible the Atlanta Falcons have been. Matt Ryan had a great game over the weekend in the 40-23 first win of the season game against the Vikings. He threw for 371 yards for 4 touchdowns. Matt Ryan, Matty Ice. Is my clear-cut go to the week. Who do you got?
All right. Can you hear me all right?
Yeah. Yep.
I'm not lagging?
So far, so good.
All right. I'll go through this quick. I don't have a traditional go to the week. But I have a little trivia question for you. You might want to pause the video, pause the audio, and think about this. What's the greatest of all time toy of all time?
Of all time?
The best-selling toy of all time. What do you think it is? I'll give you a second to think about it, Taylor. The greatest selling toy of all time. Anything come to mind?
Greatest selling toy of all time?
The greatest selling toy of all time.
I would have to go with, like,
here's a hint. Uh-huh. Rajon Rondo and Jason Kidd are probably great at this. Or great with this.
The Rubik's Cube?
The Rubik's Cube.
Oh, no shit.
That is correct.
No shit.
And the number two greatest selling toy of all time, Cabbage Patch Kid. So there you go. That's the goat toy.
Wow. Very good.
Trivia.
Very good. Very good. It's excellent. O'Reevy.
I might as well just go completely off topic when everything's going wrong.
Oh, no, it's okay. Yeah. No, it's good. It's good. Thank you so much, Reevy, for your time and for being with me this week. Cheers to you. Cheers to everybody out there listening. Go to mbnnetwork.com. It's never been easier for you to find your new favorite podcast. Also, check out youknowmeacbd.com. Use promo code MBN over there. Reevy, peace out, man. Have a great week, dude. Go Eagles. We'll see you guys next time. Make sure you go to patreon.com/mbnnetwork. We're going to putting out a all-new exclusive episode out there on Thursday and a Bruise episode on Friday. Check it out. We'll see you guys next time.